just
All right, let's get started. So it's a pleasure to welcome our speaker today for the last New York Group Series seminar of the semester. And it will be Alexey Mesnikov from the Stevens Institute of Technology. And he's going to tell us something about rich structures and weak second order logic. Alexey, please.
Thank you very much. It's always a pleasure. And we were planning to give a different talk with Andrey Nikolaev, but decided postponed for one semester. So instead, I'm talking about this, but it's actually the name. I will talk about rich groups, not just arbitrary structures. The name and the first talk about this topic was actually given a few years ago at the same seminar here. Now it seems like quite a lot of papers appeared. And there is one that I will refer quite often. It's due to Olga, myself, and Mahmoud Sohrabi at the Gacta Book 2. So I will give you what some little survey and understanding what's going on now in this area. Oops. That's what I wanted to give, but it seems like I can't. Sorry. Technical problem. Yeah, no, it's okay. Sorry about this. So the main question I will address is how expressive is first order logic in a given group? It's one of the main fundamental questions now it was in math for a long time, but now it's again coming back because of theoretical computer science, computability and formal languages. So first of all, there are several ways to which several properties or several ways to see how expressive is the first order logic in a given structure. For example, that's what quite often people do. They try to describe A up to isomorphism by all first order sentences which are true in it by the first order theory of A. So it's called describe groups elementary equivalent to given one. Or you can try to see what natural objects, for example, subgroups, are definable in a given group. If, for example, you can describe the structure A by isomorphism, it means that first order logic is quite strong. Or it also may mean that the structure is very simple. So it's a set, for example, or a divisible abelian group, torsion-free divisible abelian group. So more precisely, you can ask a little bit more. For example, if A is finitely generated, first order rigidity for A is the following property. Any finitely generated group B, which is elementary equivalent to A, is isomorphic to A. In other words, it describes all finitely generated groups satisfying the first order theory of A up to isomorphism. Even stronger, instead of all first order sentences, you can ask whether there is one single sentence which describes all such finitely generated groups. In other words, if B satisfies this sentence and finitely generated, it's isomorphic to A. First order rigidity, what was introduced by Alex Lobotsky and his team not long ago, and many groups are first order rigid. QFA properties quasi finitely axiomatizable abbreviation was introduced by André Nys and was used quite a lot by Ojer and Sabbagh before that. And many groups again are QFA.
Alexey, can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
So QFA, you're allowed to use and in the expression. So it's just a question of whether it's finitely many sentences or infinitely many sentences.
QFA, no, it's just one sentence.
But you could use and. You could have.
Yeah, sure. But it just finitely many times.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. So basically, it means finitely many sentences because you can take a conjunction. Absolutely right.
Cool.
Second type problems, typically, for example, general Maltzev problem. Describe definable subgroups in a given group. He asked about three groups, but he didn't ask because he answered himself for many such questions for finial potent groups, free solvable groups, and the classical matrix groups. He proved, for example, that finial potent group, the commutant, is definable. So the abelianization is interpretable. And you can define the rank of the group, finial potent group, by formulas. So two finial potent groups are elementary equivalent of finite rank, I mean, elementary equivalent if and only if they have the same rank. So it means isomorphic. The same for free solvable groups. The famous Maltzev results about classical matrix groups where the elementary equivalent, he used the same strategy really. In this case, not the commutant, but a lot of subgroups. For example, the field in a GLNF is definable. And it's an important thing. So he used these properties a lot in his research. For free groups, the answer turns out to be just few subgroups really are definable in a free group. Identity F and all cyclics, nothing else. The same for torsion free hyperbolic groups. We did with Olga, but Perrin, Pillais, Klinas, and Tent also did it for a bit later, but independently. So proofs are rather difficult. And it's important, he asked, for example, whether commutant is definable or not. And we know that free groups of ranks 2 and 3 say elementary equivalent, but it doesn't mean that commutants are not definable. So it's not a corollary, a free corollary of solution Tarski problems, because it might be different formulas in different ranks defined commutant. So it's very poor in terms of first order definable subgroups. Free groups are not many subgroups are definable. In finitely generated abelian groups, only finite index subgroups and finite subgroups are definable. Again, not that many. In finitely generated nilpotent groups, it's much more interesting. I don't want to get into it because it's complicated, but it's very interesting. There is a sort of quite interesting analog of linear algebra there. Homogeneous solutions, non-homogeneous, all this stuff. If you start thinking about it, the first question you might ask yourself, what is on the other side of the spectrum? What are groups where all subgroups are definable? And obviously finite groups are like that. Infinite cyclic groups are like that. For example, subgroup generated by five is defined by a formula that X is, there exists Y, that X is Y plus Y plus Y plus Y plus Y five times. So it defines the subgroup generated by five. What else? And if you think it's not easy actually to think about it, it's difficult. But then you want to get to the absolute sort of bottom. You say, okay, Let's make it even harder. What subgroups are uniformly definable? It means for any n, there exists a formula first order in n plus one variables like that. Such that if you're given n plus one elements, a1 up a and b, formula holds in G on these elements if and only if the last component B belongs to the subgroup generated by the first N. This formula defines all of them, N generated subgroups, in very nice uniform way. And the question is, are there infinite groups with uniformly definable subgroups? If you think for a minute, infinite cyclic is not like that, because there is one formula for subgroup defined by 5, but for 6 it's different formula. Not free, not torsion free hyperbolic, not Z, not finitely generated abelian that we saw. So what kind of groups are like that? It turns out many of them. That's strange, but many of them. We mentioned in our paper with Olga, KMS stands here for Kharlampovich, myself, and Sohrabi in GACTA 2 book. It's based on result of different people, but you need to prove that using their results, you prove that in Baumslag solitaire group or risk products of abelian groups like that, subgroups are uniformly definable. Three metabelian groups that I will talk about later. The Thompson group F, the classical matrix groups, we did it with Sohrabi at some point, Avni, Lubovsky, Miri proved that uniform higher rank arithmetic groups satisfy this property. That's interesting, it's not obvious. Chevalier groups of rank at least 2 over number fields, over many rings as well. But for example, this ones, the classical ones, based on result due to Siegel and Tent. And algebraically closed field groups based on results on McIntyre and Trofimov. So suddenly there are a lot of such groups. We just didn't know about them. And they're very, very, it's a variety. It's not just one type of groups. It's all over in group theory. They're not hyperbolic type sort of, but otherwise there are a lot of them. They're very different. You can ask not only about uniform definition of n-generated subgroups, but you can ask whether we can define the n-generated subgroups satisfying some particular property. Suppose P is a property of groups. We say that subgroups satisfying this property P are uniformly definable in G, in a group G. Again, if for any n, there exists a formula phi n, which depends probably on the property P, such that for any elements A1 an, G formula phi n holds on these elements in G if and only if the subgroup generated by this element satisfies P. It will distinguish or cut out precisely n-generated subgroups which satisfy property P. In the case above, it was just property P was a tautology. So just all N generated subgroups, but now you have a property P. It turns out that all the groups I mentioned above, the subgroups in those groups, the satisfying the following properties are uniformly definable. For example, free, whether subgroup is free, N generated subgroup is free, or nilpotent of class 3 or class C or solvable of class C or whatever variety you want, actually. Or it's finitely presented or not. That's a very difficult property. For example, if you can look at free metabelian groups or metabelian groups, All subfinitely generated subgroups are finitely presented in the variety of metabolic groups, but some of them are not finitely presented in the variety of all groups. So it's a big distinction, which is very difficult to distinguish. But there is a formula which just does it for us. You can write down a formula which will define precisely all finitely generated subgroups which are residually finite. You go over all finite quotients, which is kind of strange, or just go into absolutely different direction, define sub and generated subgroups where the word problem is decidable or decidable in polynomial time. That's another formula, or conjugacy problem is decidable. When you look at this, clearly it's not about subgroups. It's just something very, very powerful is there. And it goes beyond group theory because polynomial time decidability, it's about computability and so on. You can define a lot of geometric objects. Geometry is definable, geodesics, whatever you want. So it's beyond group theory. So what it could be? So it's a very high expressive power. How we can measure that it's very high or not very high, and where this expressive power comes from? We can say for subgroups, we can do QFA or something, but you can list all the properties which are definable, but still, where is the source of this expressive power? And typically the best way now as in math and logic, people think about it, it's in math and theoretical computer science, it's you have to go to logic. The natural answer could be in the following form. The first order logic over G is as expressive as some more powerful logic over G. What could be more powerful? There are two very powerful logics besides beyond first order, which contain first order logic. It's the second order logic. Basically, in this logic, you have two types of variables. One is, as usual, run over elements of a given group. And the second type run over all predicates over this group. You can use these variables to say something about predicates. So it's extremely powerful. Or you can go L omega, one omega. What does it mean? It's a very powerful logic, very famous logic in modern mathematical logic now, which allows arbitrary countable conjunctions and disjunctions of formulas. Everything else is as usual, but also you can take arbitrary conjunctions, countable conjunctions. Omega one, it means conjunctions of lengths less than omega one, first uncountable cardinal. But that's very, very powerful. That would be unbelievable. I wouldn't believe it for a second. But when I thought about it, there is no answer to the following question. Is there any infinite group where the first order logic has the same power as L omega one omega or the second order logic? I would think not, but I asked some logicians, they don't know. It's interesting. We don't know how powerful first order logic would be in groups. But that would be too much. It's excessively powerful. Nobody nowadays goes to second order logic because it's absolutely non-constructive. You can do whatever you want. Everything is too powerful anyway. There is
Alexei, yep. Can I ask another question on the previous slide? So this uniform definable property doesn't hold for free groups or something?
No.
So surely you could do uniform definability if you're allowed second order?
Yeah, absolutely. No problem at all.
Doesn't that answer the question or?
No, it's what I want. That's the essence of what I'm looking at. I would like to have to use just the usual first order logic, nothing else. But I want it in this particular group
be, to be the powerful. Same. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. That shows that they're definitely different, right?
Yeah, yeah. Right. That would be something
that rules them out, yeah.
But I didn't define what does it mean, the same expressive power. So intuitive definition. An algebraic structure is rich if the first order logic over A has the same expressive power as the weak second order logic over A. We know that, I didn't say what is the weak second order logic. Think about it, it basically, it's second order logic, but you, the second type of variables go only over finite sets, not arbitrary sets, but finite sets, finite predicates, say. It's not quite clear still, but I will make it precise. So I want to use just usual formulas, but I would like to be able to use these formulas must be so expressive, so powerful that I can do whatever usually people do in the second order logic, big second order logic. That's the idea. I need to make the definition is more precise. So there are several ways to do to explain second weak second order logic. This is one of them for group say. You have a group and group language is multiplication and the constant for the identity. And you define a bigger structure, superstructure, HF at A, as people do in logic set theory foundations as following. Inductively, you start with a set A, main set in a group. And then you take this, suppose you construct it by induction HFN of A. You take it and union with all finite subset of its of this set together. That's the next HFN plus one. So HF zero is A, then you take HF one, which is A union with all finite subsets of A, and HF two will be union of these and all finite subsets of this set. So it will be finite sets where elements are, again, finite sets, maybe. So what you construct, what people in set theory call hereditary finite sets. All sets are finite, but elements there, not just elements from A, but also finite sets and so on. And take a union. That's a set. And A, the set, original set A, sits inside. You would like to have a predicate which defines this set in the whole universe, HF of A. There is one unary predicate which defines A.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
In the first definition, HF naught of A, is that one object or as many objects as are in A?
It's a set. So if you look at the group right here, it's a set A with the operation and constant. So A here is just pure set. So you start with the set A. So it could be arbitrary set, countable and uncountable, finite, whatever.
So and HF of A ends up as a subset of A or is it a collection of subsets?
No, it will be A is a subset of HF of A.
Okay, all right.
So it's HF of A is much bigger because it contains all finite sets.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's a sub, okay, I'm fine.
Okay. And then you have predicate defines A inside this big set and you have multiplication on A and constant. So you have a group, original group. And also you have a membership predicate which works as usual on the set of HF of A. There are sets, you can ask whether one set is a member of another one. That's it, very simple structure. It's a group extended by finite sets, hereditary finite sets, and there is membership besides a group operation. You, of course, you can do it for arbitrary structures, not only groups. The same thing, just you have for rings, you will have multiplication and addition, one and zero, for example. And the main point, how people look at second order logic is the first order logic of this bigger structure has the same expressiveness as the big second order logic over A. That's how we should look at it. So I didn't say before what is second order logic over weak second order logic over A, but now we can say whatever property you can express in this structure about A is weak second order logic property. That's by definition, sort of. That's how people do it in logic nowadays. One can view elements here of two sorts. One is from A, because there is a predicate which defines A inside. So you can say something about precisely elements in A, and other from the complement here. So as in second order logic, you can have variables running over A and variables Y, capital C, running over HF of A. So this is very powerful, actual logic. It's all finite masses there. The arithmetic, the typical finite construction, tuples, whatever you want, it's there. All finite mathematics is there. And now it's a precise definition. A structure A is rich if for every first order formula phi in n variables in the language of HF of A, so it's extended language. Remember, there is a predicate membership there as well. There exists just pure first order formula phi star in the language of A, such that if you assign variables in these formulas X, assign elements just in A, not in HF of A, but just in A, then original formula, which has much more power, sort of holds in HF of A if and only if phi star holds on these elements on A. In other words, whatever you can say using powerful language of H of A about elements A1, AN here, using language of H of A superstructure, you can say just using language of A by some formula which does not have anything, no membership predicates, no hereditary finite sets, just elements from A. It's not quite clear how it's possible or not, but that's the definition. Now, bear with me for this, for next two slides. It's a little bit of logic, but it's kind of easy. Maybe a little bit formal, but I would like to present this weak second order logic in a different way now. Not many algebras are well versed in modern set theory. So to say, I understand HF of A. Yeah, that's finite mathematics standard sort of thing. But let me build an equivalent logic. So what I will do, I will build fragment of the logic L omega one, when L omega one omega, it's called AR, I put it, arithmetic fragment. What does it mean? What I will going to do? I will start with the usual formulas, first order. And I will build up the part, this fragment, explaining which precisely conjunction and disjunctions are allowed to be taken. They will be infinite, but not all of them. They will be sort of constructive only, conjunction as disjunctions. So it's defined by induction, unfortunately. So what's going on? We can enumerate, as Gödel did, of course, all first order formulas in some language. I assume for simplicity, the language is always finite, like groups, rings, whatever. You can enumerate all sentences or formulas and all sentences. So I will build my bigger formulas allowing infinite disjunctions of some sort, and I will enumerate them along the way. And for each formula, I will define complexity. So I will denote phi I formula with index I, which I built already. So you can use standard logical connectives and quantifiers as usual, and some infinite disjunctions and conjunctions that I will explain which ones. So suppose you have a set of formulas, phi, which correspond to the set of indices, I capital. Suppose this set is the following. The set of indices is arithmetic. It means it's defined by a formula of arithmetic in natural numbers or integers, doesn't matter, the same thing. Say natural numbers. Some formula by arithmetic. All my formulas have uniformly bounded complexity, say less than R. I didn't explain what complexity is yet. And they have all of them have free variable among a fixed finite list. Because I would like in the infinite conjunction of this set to have only finitely many free variables. Then infinite conjunctions are they give formulas in our fragment that I'm building, arithmetical fragment. So what are conditions? The set of indices is an arithmetic set, and complexity is uniformly bounded, and variables are uniformly bounded, which is absolutely natural. So what's the complexity? In first order logic, complexity is pi s or sigma s. It's a number of alternation of quantifiers in the prenext normal form. You have quantifiers in front, and how many times there are change from for all to exist and back. That's the complexity of the formula. Famous arithmetical hierarchy based sigma n and pi n is based on it. So we have this complexity. But if you have infinite disjunction, complexity may go up. For example, so you have S, it's an index of the arithmetic set I. Every arithmetic set has complexity because it's defined by a formula of some complexity, sigma n or pi n. So if arithmetic set has complexity S, and all complexity of formulas phi bounded by R, complexity of infinite disjunction will be maximum of RS plus one. It goes by one. It's quite natural. In this complexity, we sort of also count the complexity of the set of indices. And there is old beautiful theorem due to Belyaev and Tyson. I forgot what the year. I think 69 or 70 something. I forgot. Sorry. Which says that the fragment we built is absolutely equivalent to HF of A. So let me say it precisely. For every formula in the fragment, so it might contain infinite disjunction and conjunction, there is formula phi star in the same variables in the language of the superstructure HF of A, such that if for variables we assign elements in A, so phi of A and an makes sense, and we can ask whether it holds in A or not. So it holds in A, and phi contains infinite disjunctions. If and only if phi star, which is ordinary first order formula, but in the language is the richer language over HF of A, if it holds in HF of A. So infinite disjunction does not give much more than HF of A. And the second statement says that the converse is also true. For every formula in H of A, you construct psi star, which is in our fragment, which is equivalent like that. MA, it means structure, not a Mascal A. Sorry about this. Here, MA, it's Mascal A. It should be this A, the same A. They prove that the fragment they described is equivalent to weak second order logic. So it's very, very convenient actually to use this type of weak second order logic. Now, using this machinery, it's very easy to describe why subgroups are uniformly definable in rich groups. Given number n, consider an effective enumeration of all group works in variables x1, xn. It may contain group, it means inverses are allowed. You enumerate them one by one, all of them, and take disjunction of this formula, which says y is equal one of the words on x1, xn. So this formula basically says that y belongs to the subgroup generated by x1, xn. So if your group is rich, for this weak second order logic formula, there is first order logic formula, which is equivalent to this one in the group. So you're using this one, this first order logic formula equivalent to this one, and it defines all n generated subgroups uniformly. So it's very, very convenient. The only question, how I can prove that richness of a group. But before that, looking again at the groups that we discussed above, all those groups that I mentioned are rich. It's not about subgroups. It's not even about groups. It's just they are strange groups that first order language is extremely powerful. You can express huge properties by just pure first order formulas in these groups. Take Thompson group F that some people here know well and well. It's not obvious that you can do it, but yeah, you can.
Do all of these groups model arithmetic?
Say it again.
Do all of these groups model arithmetic?
In particular, yes. Yes, much more. But as I said, weak second order logic allows you to have arithmetic in particular, but all finite mass basically. Yes, the answer is yes. There are very many rich rings and semigroups as well. Z, Q, Z, for example, that's recursion theory. It tells you that all these things are there. Of course, arithmetic is there. It's Lagrange theorem. Natural numbers are just sum of four squares. But you go to number fields, that's a result of Julia Robinson, or rings of algebraic integers. That's also a result of Julia Robinson, free associative algebra. That's our result with Olga, but also free monoids, various free one related monoids. It's a result of Olga and her PhD student. I will talk about it a bit later. So it's not specific to groups. Now I will say a few words how one can prove that a given structure is Dirich. I need the notion of bi-interpretability of structures, which became quite popular during the last decade. It came from model theory and logic. Now it came to number theory first, I think, group theory, but number theory people understood the power of this thing, I think, a little bit earlier. And now it's all over. So what is this? There is this old notion that one algebraic structure is interpretable in another algebraic structure. Like the center is interpretable in a group, or quotient group by the center is interpretable in the original group. I don't want to give definitions. It's too technical, and I gave it several times at this seminar. It doesn't help though, but anyway. It came from logic when they tried to prove that something is the equations or elementary theory is undecidable by interpreting arithmetic. But then people used it for stability, for every time you use for different things. And then they realized this is the proper notion how to say that one structure knows everything about the other structure, sort of. And you can use it in many different ways. So it's a very important technique. In number theory, as I said, they call it differently. And they use it just for fields mostly, but I don't want to get to it. They use a special case. They used it before. Now they use a standard, this one, definition. So suppose A and B arbitrary structures, for example, group and ring, such that one is interpretable in the other, like a quotient group of the other one, say. Oops, what did I do? I did something which I didn't want. Okay, I'm back. So B is interpretable in A. In other words, for example, you take a center, take the quotient that you're and the quotient group is isomorphic to B. So quotient group is B star, it's isomorphic to B. That's an interpretation of B as B star in A. But also A is interpretable in B, maybe as a commutant, whatever, something. They are mutually interpretable in each other, but it's not enough. The important condition that was missed for very many years that A star sits inside A somehow, is defined on the tuples. And there is equivalence relation and the quotient set and so on. But it sits inside. So A is isomorphic to A star. And this, and there is an isomorphism which is definable in A. There is a formula which defines this isomorphism. That's crucial. And the same for B. These are called bi-interpretable. In a sense, they are the same. You can say group and ring bi-interpretable each other. It means that basically they are incarnation, group incarnation and ring incarnation of the same thing. And typical example is you have SLN, special linear group over say commutative ring R, and they are bi-interpretable with each other. So they are just really the same incarnation of something which is common, which sits, it's not a group, not a ring, but it's, in interpretation class. For example, in this case, you can say they're absolutely different. One is a ring, another is a group, but they have the same algebraic geometry, for example, because they categories of algebraic sets or equivalent to categories of coordinate algebras are isomorphic, equivalent. Or you can say a lot of things, but that's a definition. And the first result, which is kind of strange, if you have finitely generated nilpotent group, using sort of Maltsev technique, one can show that Z is interpretable. The arithmetic is interpretable in G. That's why equations there are undecidable. But G has a decidable word problem. Any finitely generated group with decidable word problem is interpretable in Z by sigma one actually formulas. But there is no definable isomorphism that I described. You take Heisenberg group on the center, you interpret Z. In this Z, you interpret again back Heisenberg group, but it does not have anything in common with the original one. They don't know about each other. So they're not bi-interpretable. And the main technical result is if A is bi-interpretable with HF of A, then A is rich. That's the main tool. Slight generalization is if A is bi-interpretable with H of B for some structure B, then A is rich again. Or in most general form, if A is bi-interpretable with a rich structure B, then A is rich again. By interpretability inherits all the properties, and in particular richness. You have to prove it, but that's the result. For example, structures bi-interpretable with N, Z, or Q are rich. Some of the groups that I mentioned from the beginning are bi-interpretable with Z. That's why the result holds, like Thompson group of, or SLN, or GLN, SLN, or Chevalier groups. In particular, and free metabelian groups of finite rank, non-abelian, they are bi-interpretable with Z. Therefore, they are rich. The case rank two was done by Kilif, but his proof doesn't go for higher ranks. We did it with Olga and Mahmoud. And immediately we have answering some old questions that all subgroups are definable, even more uniformly definable. Finitely presented subgroups are definable. And that's the old question, which is the set of bases is definable. Remember, in free groups, the set of bases is not definable. And G is QFA, prime and homogeneous. I don't want to get prime and homogeneous things now, but it's QFA. But it's rich. So it's all the properties that studied before, they're there. It's nice. You can define everything which is reasonable. It's much harder to come up with something you cannot define than is something that you can define. Because whatever you define is definable in weak second order logic. You're not going usually out of arithmetical sets. Much more is known the last 2 years about rings and fields. For example, there is a description of finitely generated commutative of unitary rings by interpretable with N given by this team just a year ago. I don't want to have general criteria, but what is nice, every infinite finitely generated integral domain is bi-interpretable with N, therefore it's rich. So all finitely generated domains, integral domains are rich. For example, as I said, then SLN over such domains are rich. So anyway, that's a big result, I think, in commutative algebra. In number theory, Dittmann and Pop, also a year ago, they published beautiful result answering some open question that if you have infinite finitely generated field, then its reach, unless one case when characteristic in two is two, you need to assume some condition, resolution of singularities above F2, but I don't want to get into it. So except for a few exceptions, it's reach. For example, all number fields, finite algebraic extension of Q, they are reach. Algebraic integers are also reach. But interesting that richness not comes only with interpretability with arithmetic. Now, we proved four years ago now, that if you have a free non-abelian group and K arbitrary field could be uncountable, then group algebra, free group algebra, K of F, is bi-interpretable with HF of K for arbitrary K. Is bi-interpretable with H of K. So the group algebra K of F has HF of K inside somehow. And it's equivalent actually to HF of K. Notice that if K is uncountable, it cannot be by definition be interpretable with Z, because whatever you interpret with Z is countable. But beyond, not all fields are bi-interpretable with Z. For example, algebraically closed completion of Q in C is countable, but cannot be bi-interpretable with Z because it has decidable theory. So it's much more complicated than interpretability with Z. It turns out the same results holds for free associative algebras. Kx, free associative algebra with basis X over field K, is bi-interpretable with HF of K, with the field. So associative algebra over finite basis, non-abelian though, is basically HF of K, essentially. I think it's true for many things. Here, important thing was least superstructure, not HF of A. We used, to prove it, we used least superstructure. Let me say a few words about it. What is least superstructure? You start with some structure A, for example, a group. You add arithmetic as a second set. And you have S of A, the set of all tuples over A, finite tuples. Arithmetic comes with operations, multiplication and addition as usual. It's standard arithmetic. And you have concatenation of tuples and you have length function. And you can pick arbitrary component of the tuple. It is in the language. You're allowed to do it. Nothing else though. And it turns out that you show that free group algebra is bi-interpretable with S of, instead of A, we have the field here, least superstructure over the field. And that's very convenient to do it this way. The last topic I would like to say a few words about algebraically and existentially closed groups. It was big topic. People started with algebraically closed groups and then semigroups and so on. Many classes. What they proved in, you can unify, and that what Beliaev and Teislin sort of did in different, completely different language. But if you work on what they did and the guys, the pioneers, did. You combine and what you get that existentially closed objects in the following classes of structures, all groups or torsion free groups or semigroups with cancellation, inverse semigroups, skew fields or associative rings, all of them have existentially closed struct objects. And all these existentially closed objects are rich. And all the properties that this team established for this group, they come from richness, really. What you can think that what they prove that these objects are rich. And then they didn't do it, but using their techniques, you can do it. They just didn't have this language or idea. But all the properties they established come from richness. How did they do that? They used yet another approach to weak second order logic. You have a structure A, you consider a new set of all finite binary predicates, FBP, finite binary predicate. And you have the predicate S, which tells you when pair of elements AB belongs to the finite predicate H on A. It's very simple. So what's the difference between second order logic and this one? It's finite predicates, finite binary. You can use arbitrary finite, but finite predicates, not arbitrary predicates. And it's not easy to show that, it's not difficult to show that HF of A and FBP of A are biinterpretable in each other. Absolutely, it means you don't need any constants. So this superstructure is the same as this one. So it gives you second order logic, and that's the result. Now, what are implications for groups? It's known that non-trivial algebraically closed groups are also existentially closed. Algebraically, it means equations. Existentially, it means all existential formulas, much more. But they're the same. You need to prove it, but it's done. So every algebraically closed group is existentially closed, so it's rich. And it's known that every countable group embeds into a countable algebraically closed, which is simple actually, rich group. So every countable group embeds into a rich group. And the last result I would like to tell today is because I don't think I have enough time for open problems, but there is a question. I show that that's only beginning in commutative algebra, number theory, and group theory, people discover more and more rich groups. But how often you can see rich groups? Among finitely presented groups, most of them are, according to standard models, are, say, hyperbolic. How about countable groups? And there is a result. If you consider countably infinite groups with a fixed underlying set, you can form a Polish space and its standard notion with a suitable metric. And group property P is called generic if the subset of groups in this Polish space, which satisfy property P, is Kamiga. Kamiga, it means sort of probability one. Miga is small, negligible. Kamiga is large, almost everything. People usually say that they studied this object for a long time ago. They say if the set of groups satisfying P is Kamiga, the generic infinite countable group satisfies P, like in finitely presented case. Recently, this year, this team proved that a generic infinite countable group is algebraically closed. So it's actually its rich. So we know what a typical finitely presented group, but if you go just countable groups, they're algebraically closed, so they are rich. So the property that I described from the beginning as a surprising property, it's actually a generic property. So most of the groups are rich. And the rich groups, of course, QFA, I don't want to get into it there are interesting problems, which I also would like to skip. If you would ask questions, I can return to it. But the last question for algebraists, actually, and logicians. What is the weak second order logic? Because it's convenient to it shows up in algebra in different incarnations, like HF logic via superstructure HF of A, which I started with, which is long and a beautiful history of HFF logic and admissible sets. It's a big theory in set theory and recursion theory. But it's also, as I said, logic of lists, which comes as a through the list superstructure. And this is typical thing in generalized computability. That's how they look at it. They don't look at HF of A. There is a logic of binary predicates, finite binary predicates, which sort of comes from the classics, from existentially closed groups. And there is this fragment that Beliaev and Tansley constructed, arithmetic fragment of omega one omega, which is convenient, as I showed. It's the same, actually. Instead of arithmetic, you use just recursive. It's equivalent, I'm saying. So it turns out, if you merge all this into one, you say, let's consider logic, which is, you can use all these tools if you want. So it's very convenient. It's basically, it's whatever you ever use. What we proved with Beliaev recently, and that's not easy, that all of them are effectively equivalent. In other words, if you're given a formula in one logic, one can effectively find a formula in another logic, which is equivalent to original one over A. So it's efficient. It's not easy, because when you build up infinite disjunctions, say, arithmetic sets are not unique to describe, which describe these indices. So it's a complicated thing. It goes to set of notations developed for forking and thing working with recursion theory, big things. But it's true. So it's the equivalent and effectively equivalent. And the last result is the following. If you have infinite structure of finite language, finite signature, that is bi-interpretable with HF of itself, so it's rich, then for every formula of this combined logic, all this weak, this sort of the largest weak second order logic over A, one can effectively find a usual first order formula phi star, which is equivalent to this complicated maybe formula equivalent over A to the simple one first order language formula phi. So whatever you use using infinite disjunction conjunctions, you can actually translate efficiently. It's an algorithm to first order formula. Okay, I think I should stop here. Thank you very much.
All right, okay, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, so now if there are any questions for Alexei, you're welcome to ask them.
Can you say a few more words about this universal weak second order logic?
Yeah, I didn't mention. So basically, what do you have here? You can use here, you can use all finite hereditary finite set and membership predicate, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you add all tuples. You can use as a separate sort of variables. You can use all these tuples.
So basically, you're getting them together.
Yeah, or, precisely. It's a union of all these things. Mm-hmm. So, and then suddenly you can use infinite arithmetic conjunction and disjunctions, which also which also not only have standard first order formulas, but also tuples and all the things that you add. So it's extremely powerful thing. Mm-hmm. It's how I look at it. When you know that your object is rich, to show that some property is definable, you use this union, this the largest logic. But if you want to prove that something is rich, you pick the one that you like, that Olga we did with you for free group algebra, say. We pick lists because it's very convenient. And McIntyre, for example, or Newman used finite binary predicates for algebraically closed structures because it's very convenient there.
But basically for the universal one, you just get everything together.
Yeah, and crucial thing that you can take infinite formulas which contains first order tuples, sets, whatever you want, arithmetic, all this you can use in your formulas and you can combine infinite conjunctions. Mm-hmm. Conjunctions.
Nice.
So is rich equivalent to bi-interpretable with Z?
No, that's a point. If you take, as I said, let me maybe go back. That's an important question and an important point. For example, this result. K is an arbitrary field. Kx is a free associative algebra with coefficients in K. It's non-commutative polynomials. It's a ring, nothing else. It's just addition and multiplication and zero and one constants, nothing in this language. What we proved with Olga that this ring as a ring is bi-interpretable with HF of K. So it's rich, but K is an arbitrary field, for example, real numbers. It's not countable, so it cannot be interpretable with Z because whatever you interpret with Z is countable. And more, which I like, much, much more difficult, but much more interesting for group theory, if you have free group algebra with coefficient in arbitrary field K also could be uncountable. Then the same result. This ring as ring, not an algebra, but ring, is bi-interpretable with HF of K. So it's again rich, but not, in most cases will not be bi-interpretable with Z. Yeah, that's a good point. Because right now in number theory, people are starting sort of to work bi-interpretability with Z. But I think if you go a little bit higher, and say Chevalier groups over reals. That's very interesting. And they're so bi-interpretable. Yep.
If I restrict the question to countable structures?
Again, very good thing, very good question. For example, not all finitely generated commutative rings are rich. There is a criterion right now. So some of them are rich, some of them are not. Integral domains, yes, if there are no zero divisors, they are rich. But many of them, most of them, I think, in some sense, again, what was the distribution, but many of them are not rich and they are not bi-interpretable with Z.
So the question would be, in the countable structures, is bi-interpretable with Z the same as being rich?
And yeah, but the answer is, let me say again, it's you take, for example, SLN, the group, special linear group, right, over you even simpler, take a free associative algebra over a countable field, which is not bi-interpretable with Z. And there are many of them. Even finitely generated commutative ones like that. But a free associative algebra, which will be countable ring, is rich. is always rich. The same for other, there are many examples like that. For example, I believe most of algebraically closed rings are not by interpretable with Z, but they are rich.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Are there any other questions? Okay. If not, let us thank Alexei again. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll stop the recording now.